Audio presents Beat the Reaper, written by Josh Bazell, read by Robert Petkoff.
So I'm on my way to work and I stop to watch a pigeon fight a rat in the snow and some fuckhead tries to mug me. Naturally, there's a gun. It comes up behind me and sticks it into the base of my skull. It's cold, and it actually feels sort of good in an acupressure kind of way.
"Take it easy, Doc," he says.
Which explains that, at least. Even at 5 a.m, I'm not the kind of guy you mug. I look like an Easter Island sculpture of a longshoreman. But the fuckhead can see the blue scrub pants under my overcoat and the ventilated green plastic clogs, so he thinks I've got drugs and money on me. And maybe that I've taken some kind of oath not to kick his fuckhead ass for trying to mug me. I barely have enough drugs and money to get me through the day, and the only oath I took, as I recall, was to first do no harm. I'm thinking we're past that point. "Okay," I say, raising my hands. The rat and the pigeon run away. Chicken shits. I turn around, which rolls the gun off my skull and leaves my raised right hand above the fuckhead's arm. I wrap his elbow and jerk upward, causing the ligaments to pop like champagne corks. Let's take a moment to smell the rose known as the elbow. The two bones of the forearm, the ulna and the radius, move independently of each other and also rotate. You can see this by turning your hand from palm up, in which position the ulna and radius are parallel, to palm down, where they're crossed into an X. And you can compare this to your lower leg, where the same setup is vestigial. The two bones of the lower leg, the tibia and fibula, are locked in place. The outer one, the fibula, doesn't even support weight. In fact, you can take most of it out to use as a graft or whatever, and as long as you don't fuck up the ankle or the knee, it won't affect the patient's ability to walk. They therefore require a complicated anchoring system at the elbow, with the ligaments wrapping the various bone ends in spoolable and unspoolable ribbons that look like the tape on the handle of a tennis racket. It's a shame to tear these ligaments apart. But the fuckhead and I have a worse problem right now, namely that while my right hand has been fucking up his elbow, my left, having somehow come into position by my right ear, is now hooking toward his throat in a knife edge. If it hits, it will crush the fragile rings of cartilage that keep his trachea open against the vacuum of breathing in. Next time he tries, his windpipe will clench shut like an anus, leaving him at Reaper time minus maybe 6 minutes, even if I ruin my propulsatile pen trying to trach him. So I beg and plead and coax the trajectory of my hand upwards, past the point where it's aiming for his chin or even his mouth, which would have been disgusting, to where it's aiming for his nose, which caves in like wet clay. Wet clay with twigs in it. The fuckhead crashes to the pavement, unconscious. I check to make sure I'm calm. I am, I'm just annoyed, before I get heavily to my knees down next to him. In this kind of work, as in every kind of work probably, planning and composure are worth a lot more than speed. Not that this particular situation requires much planning or composure. I roll the fuckhead onto his side so he won't choke to death, and bend the arm that isn't broken under his head to keep his face off the frozen sidewalk. Then I check to make sure he's still breathing. He is, in fact, with a bubbly joie de vivre. Also, the pulses at his wrists and ankles are reasonably strong. So, as is usual in these situations, I imagine asking the Great One, Professor Marmoset, whether I can leave now. And as is also usual in these situations, I imagine Professor Marmoset saying, "No," and, "What would you do if he was your brother?" I sigh. I don't have a brother, but I know what he's getting at. I put my knee into the guy's fucked up elbow and pull the bones as far apart as the tendons feel likely to bear, then let them come slowly back together into their positions of least resistance. It makes the fuckhead groan in pain in his sleep, but whatever. They'd just do the same to him in the ER, only by then he'd be awake. I frisk him for a cell phone. No such luck, of course, and I'm not about to use my own. If I did have a brother, would he want me getting hassled by the cops? So instead, I pick the fuckhead up and fold him over my shoulder. He's light and stinky like a urine-logged towel. And before I stand, I pick up his handgun. The gun is a real piece of shit. two pieces of pressed sheet metal, no grips even, and a slightly off-center cylinder. It looks like something that began life as a starter pistol at a track meet. For a second, it makes me feel better about there being 350 million handguns in the United States. Then I see the bright brass ends of the bullets, and I'm reminded how little it takes to kill someone. I should throw it out, bend the barrel and drop it down a storm drain. Instead, I slip it into the back pocket of my scrub pants. Old habits die harder than that. In the elevator up to medicine, there's a small blonde drug rep in a black party dress with a roller bag. She's got a flat chest, and the arch of her back boosts her ass, so she's shaped like a sexy, slender kidney bean. She's 26 after a bit too much sun exposure, and her nose is the kind that looks like a nose job but isn't. Freckles, I shit you not. Her teeth are the cleanest things in the hospital. Doctors always know how old you are. We use it to tell whether you're lying to us. There are various formulas for it, compare the creases of the neck to the veins on the backs of the hands and so on, but they're not really necessary. If you met 30 people a day and asked them how old they were, you'd get good at it too.
Hi,
she says, like she's from Oklahoma.
Do I know you?
Not yet, no, I say, thinking, because you're new on this job or you wouldn't have such shitty hours.
Are you an orderly?
She asks. I'm an intern in internal medicine. An intern is a first-year resident, 1 year out of medical school, so typically about 6 years younger than I am. I don't know what an orderly is. It sounds like someone who works in an insane asylum, if there are still insane asylums.
Wow, the drug rep says. You're cute for a doctor.
If by cute, she means brutal and stupid-looking, which, in my experience, most women do, she's right. My scrub shirt is so tight you can see the tattoos on my shoulders. Snake staff on the left, Star of David on the right. The tattoo on my left shoulder, winged staff, two snakes, turns out to actually be the symbol of Hermes, and therefore of commerce. The symbol of Asclepius, and therefore of medicine, is a non-winged staff with one snake. Who knew? You're from Oklahoma, I ask her.
Well, yes, I am.
You're 22?
I wish, 24.
You took a couple years off.
Yes, but oh my God, that is a boring story.
It's okay so far. What's your name?
Stacy,
she says, stepping closer with her arms behind her back. I should say here that being chronically sleep-deprived is so demonstrably similar to being drunk that hospitals often feel like giant, ceaseless office Christmas parties. Except that at a Christmas party, the schmuck standing next to you isn't about to fillet your pancreas with something called a hot knife. I should also maybe say that drug reps, of whom there is one for every seven physicians in the U.S., get paid to be flirtatious, or else to actually fuck you. I've never been quite clear on that. What company do you work for? I ask.
Martin Whiting Alamed, she says.
Got any moxifene? Moxifene is the drug they give to bomber pilots who need to take off from Michigan, bomb Iraq, then fly back to Michigan without stopping. You can swallow it or use it to run the engine.
Well, yes, I do. But what are you going to give me in return?
What do you want? I say. She's right up under me.
What do I want? If I start thinking about that, I'll start crying. Don't tell me you want to see that.
Beats going to work. She gives me the play slap and leans over to unzip her bag. If she's wearing underwear, it's not of any technology I'm familiar with.
Anyway, she says, it's just things like a career, or not having three roommates, or not having parents who think I should have stayed in Oklahoma. I don't know that you can help me with that.
She stands up with a sample pack of moxifene and a pair of derma gels, the Martin Whiting Aldamed $18 rubber gloves. She says,
in the meantime, I might settle for showing you our new gloves.
I've tried them, I say.
Have you ever tried kissing someone through them?
No.
Neither have I, and I've been kind of dying to.
She hip-checks the elevator stop button.
Oops,
she says. She bites the cuff off one of the gloves to tear it open, and I laugh. You know that feeling where you're not sure whether you're being hustled or in the presence of an actual human being? I love that feeling. The ward is a fucking nightmare. Akfal, the other intern on my service, says when I finally show up to relieve him. What hello is to civilians, the ward is a fucking nightmare is to interns. Akfal is a J-card from Egypt. J-cards are graduates of foreign medical schools whose visas can be rescinded if they don't keep their residency directors happy. Another good word for them would be slaves. He hands me a printout of current patients. He's got one too, though his is marked up and heavily creased, and talks me through it. Blah blah room 809 South, blah blah colostomy infection, blah 37-year-old woman for regularly scheduled chemotherapy, blah 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 blah.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.